ready to go around the world? Sit back, relax, and buckle your seatbelt as we take off for an adventure. It's jet lag free, but filled full of fun and travel insights. The only thing you'll need to pack is a sense of humor. Time for the award-winning travel show, Around the World.
Well, greetings, Globetrotters and Armchair Travelers. Welcome to Around the World. I'm Arthur von Wiesenberger, and you must be...
I must be Martha Bull.
She is indeed in the co-pilot's seat as we travel across the globe, and good to see you, and we have a great show today. So many exciting places to go, so little time. So we better tell you, we're starting off in Italy, which I love, and Bonnie Tanny LeBlanc, who normally gives us New York report,
right.
She just got back from Italy, so she's going to give us all the inside scoop on everything molto bene. Then I'm taking you on the first of the Best of Switzerland episodes.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, I just completed a two-week trip through Switzerland, went to some amazing places, and this will be the first installment, which is actually about Swiss International Airlines, which is how I got there.
They have new planes, right?
They just got the first 777 from Boeing.
Okay.
It arrived on the 29th of January. And
you were there to greet it?
I was there to shake its little hand, or big hand in the case of a Boeing 777. Later on in the show, we're going to be finding out all about Seattle from Scott Steepleton of the Santa Barbara News Press. He just came back, and he's got some good insights for folks who want to go up and visit.
Are there amusement parks up there?
If you find rain amusing, you just look up in the sky.
Because he normally covers.
He does. Yeah. I'm sure he. I think he went to Dale Chihuly's exhibition of, you know, he's a glass blower up there.
Oh, I know.
Have you been to that?
I have not been there, but I've seen his work.
It's amazing.
You can go
and see what he's doing. And I think he also has a restaurant there. So we'll find out all about that at the Seattle Center. Then later on, Rebecca Warren is going to be joining us. And Rebecca is with Lonely Planet, and they have announced the number one place this year in the USA. The number one city. We're going to reveal it.
Okay.
I'm not going to let you look yet. All righty, we're going to find out about that and much, much more in this edition Around the World. But first, it is time for Travel News.
Travel News is brought to you by the internet website, ATW.TV. ATW.TV is the first place to go, even to visit the last place on Earth. Place you've been.
And indeed, there are many places we've been, and if you want to see those places, not only is Around the World on ATW.TV, but now we are pleased to say we've joined the Cox Cable family, and you can watch us every week on Channel 17. Sundays at 10 p.m. It's rebroadcasted again Tuesdays at 9 a.m. What a great way to start the day.
Uh-huh.
And then on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. So there are three chances every week to watch Around the World right there on Cox Cable.
Yeah.
Channel 17.
Okay, so there's a new thing in the Atlanta airport. Mothers can now breastfeed in private following the installation of what's called nursing pods. And apparently it features digital tablets, fold-down table, private seating, and a power supply. And apparently they cost like $15,000 for these pods, but apparently it's paid for by people that are advertising. And they've got four of them in the airport right now, and they're saying that if demand is good, they may end up adding more, and I suspect that these will start popping up in other airports as well. I mean, it's nice to go into private. Otherwise, you're stuck going into the bathroom or having to hide yourself in the corner of a, you know, waiting lounge.
I've never had that problem.
Well, I know you haven't, but
I have seen moms who have cried over spilt milk when it's breast milk.
What's with you?
Because it's National Spilt Milk.
Oh, is that why?
Don't cry over spilt milk day today.
Oh, I did not. I caught the last of that. That was on the previous show when it was table talk. Okay, good.
Speaking about crying, can you imagine taking a trip on the Titanic?
No.
Would you want to?
Well, not the one that's at the bottom of the ocean.
Well, they're making another one.
Yeah.
And they're gonna relaunch it, and it's apparently a $300 million replica of the doomed ocean liner, which is due to set sail, this new one, 2018. It's planned by Blue Star. The Titanic II will stick to the incredible detail of the original ship, which sank in 1912.
Right.
Titanic II's launch has been pushed to 2018, with a maiden voyage planned from China to Dubai. Amenities will include a small swimming pool, Turkish baths, a gym with Edwardian equipment. Now, I didn't know that they did any kind of gym work back in the Edwardian days. I mean, other than maybe playing with a medicine ball.
Yeah.
Wasn't that what the main thing was? I don't know. And they're going to have a squash court.
Interesting.
So it's kind of going to be like stepping back in time in a way.
Will they have TVs, though?
Well, they don't need them because what's going to happen is the ship's going to sink on its maiden voyage. So there's no point.
There's the ever optimist.
Just bring your life jacket. That's all I can say. No, any case, it's a 300 to 400 million pound project, which to me is just
pretty
staggering to imagine.
Interesting.
And, the Titanic was probably one of the most controversial ships ever built. Would you want to build a second one? I don't quite get it, but maybe... You know, if it's built to such incredible detail, just don't sail around any icebergs.
Exactly.
Stay in warm waters. This ship, at the time, it was the largest ship in the world. It carried 2,224 people.
Yeah.
So I think this new one is going to be doing about the same. So.
And I wonder if it's ever going to come over to the Atlantic.
One time.
One time only.
Yeah.
And half of the way there. Okay. Can you imagine getting on a flight and having a passenger so drunk that he's going, "We're all going to die," and starts to hurl bottles and threaten to kill passengers?
I didn't mean it when I did that. I really didn't. I was just.
It was just too
much tequila. Jole.
Apparently, this guy, this plane was bound from Boston to San Diego, and he was just absolutely obnoxious. And like I said, he was threatening people. So the pilot decided that he was going to divert the plane, and they ended up landing in Denver to let him off. And they said apparently this one woman tweeted. She said after the drunk belligerent man was removed, she wrote, "God bless him. He thought the cops were his car service and asked them to make sure his luggage got to his house."
That's pretty great. Well, a Malaysian went screaming to the customs officials in New Zealand and said, "I haven't done anything wrong." He was bringing in a cow patty.
Why?
From Malaysia. Well, it was for a Hindu ceremony that was going to go on in New Zealand.
Okay.
But he did the right thing in that he did declare to the customs agents that he was carrying a cow dung patty.
You can't bring
dung patties in there. There seems to be a lot of bio issues in dung patties, and especially from Malaysia. My goodness gracious me! So he wasn't allowed to bring it in, and he went, "Oh poo." But there you go.
This is going to be a very long show.
It's a very long show. Okay.
Very long. Yeah.
Anything else?
No. That's it.
That wraps up our travel news. Again, travel news is brought to you by the internet website, www.aetw.tv, the first place to go, even to visit the last place on Earth. And we're going to find out all about Italy coming up next with Bonnie, Tandy, LeBlanc. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Could count on it being there with the rise of the sun. We're proud to say we've been there every day with you. The Santa Barbara News Press plans to continue sharing the news of the day with you all through the year and beyond. It's nice to know there are some things you can still count on. The Santa Barbara News Press, serving Santa Barbara since 1855.
The Colossus of Rhodes, the Great Pyramid of Giza, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Just tune in to the award-winning travel show Around the World, live on Thursdays on AM 1290 and at www.atw.tv, with rebroadcasts on Thursdays at 8 p.m. and again on Saturdays at 10 a.m. for the only list that really stands out and can stand the test of time.
And welcome back to Around the World. We are traveling across the globe. You know, whenever I was just talking about eating in Europe, and of course I ate amazingly well on my recent trip that I just came back from. But there's always a place to go find out all about food. It's called biteofthebest.com.
Okay.
And you know who has that wonderful website?
Bonnie.
Our very own Bonnie Tani LeBlanc, who's joining us now, and we're all going to find out about Italia. Hello, Bonnie.
Hello, Arthur, and I promise I'm not going to share with you about any dung patties.
Well, you know, I mean, we got to start somewhere, and that's usually ground zero, so to speak, of good food. But, you know, Bonnie, we're always thinking about eating well, and of course, you are the maven of fine food and all the things that go to make a good meal, especially in the kitchen. But Italy is kind of a no-brainer as far as fine food. It's like one of the greatest destinations in the world, isn't it?
It absolutely is. I've been all over the world, but I have to say that for food, Italy is always the place to go. It just amazes me how wonderful it is.
It's hard not to get a great meal. I mean, it's one of those places where even if you go to the smallest little trattoria or osteria or even just a sandwich joint on the autostrada, you're going to walk away going, wow, that was great.
Right, because it's simple. They do simple, fresh food, and it's wonderful. And I spend most of my time, not all, but in the Emilia-Romagna area, which is like a food paradise.
That's up like where Bologna is, right, in that area?
Yes. Yes, Bologna, Modena, which is where the balsamico is from.
Right.
You know, what's interesting to me is Americans think of balsamic vinegar as something to douse the salad in. Huh. But it's really something much more special than that. I actually got a tour of the factory, one of the factories there, and I was just so impressed. And the vinegar was so wonderful, you would drink it. I know that sounds a little funny, but I mean, because it's so syrupy and very special. Like, you would drizzle it over ice cream or have it as an after-dinner digestive or
on strawberries.
Strawberry.
Yeah, I love the strawberry one. And I think, don't they start with like an ancient balsamic vinegar that they keep adding to, so you've got a lot of history in that balsamic you're tasting?
Very impressed, Arthur. They absolutely do. The company that I visited was Monari Federzoni. I'm sorry, I can't pronounce it so well. And it's the oldest Italian company that's making the balsamic vinegar. And again, that was in Modena. And they have a new one that's coming out this spring called Passion. And they might have changed the name for America, but it's a bottle that has a picture of a rose. And I have to tell you this interesting story about the rose is that they plant a rose bush at the end of the grapes. They do grow all their own grapes for the vinegar. And why do they plant a rose bush? Not for beauty, but because once they see that the rose bush has been attacked by insects, they know that the insects are going to attack the grapes, and then they treat the grapes. They don't do it until then. So it's kind of, I thought that was a fascinating little tidbit of wineries, you know, vineyards, that that the bugs will first attack the flowers before they go for the grapes.
Now, do those bugs, are they going around like little Ferraris? Because isn't a Ferrari right around the corner?
also, the was wonderful with Parmigiano Reggiano, and I did go to one of those factories too. Mm-hmm. There is nothing like fresh Parmesan cheese. You know, that's been, of course, it's been aged for years, which is why it's so expensive, because all their capital is sitting in a warehouse for a couple of years. But it has these crystals, kind of protein crystals in it that are crunchy, and it just is the most wonderful cheese to nibble with a little balsamico.
Especially when they just cut it open and it's still got a lot of moisture in it, because it does kind of crumble in your mouth, not in your hands. You know?
Yes.
Did you go to the place, I mean, where they had these wheels just one on top of another as far as you could see?
I did, and I believe there should be a photo behind you at some point of those.
Yep, there it is.
And
you know, I mean, I understand that banks will loan money on Parmesan that's stored like that.
Right, you mortgage your cheese. Yeah. Absolutely, because you have to keep, you know, you need money to continue making it. And we were there early in the morning, and the men, what I heard is it's a family business. And the reason is they work from morning till night. They work 365 days a year. You need to milk the cows and make the cheese every day. So they have it as a family business, so they're all together for all those holidays and things when everyone else is taking off.
Now, I bet they cry over spilt milk, right?
Right.
It's expensive stuff. Hey,
wonderful.
For our listeners and viewers, interesting point of difference between Reggiano Parmigiano and Gran Padana, which is another kind of, you see it in markets a lot, another kind of Parmesan. One comes on from one side of the river and one comes from the other, right?
Right, and they have a DOP designation, which is a denomination of protected origin that the government gives, so that you know that by using the name Grana Padano or using the name Parmigiano Reggiano, you know exactly where it came from. Nothing else can be called that.
Right.
You know, like champagne can only be called if it came from the Champagne region.
And I think that the difference with these two cheeses is that the grasses on the other side of the river where those cows graze are different from the grasses where the Reggiano cows graze. So it has a different flavor.
It is. And also what I found interesting is prosciutto di Parma.
Yep.
They feed the pigs the drained whey from the cheese making.
No way.
You are on top of things today, aren't you?
I guess I'm on top of the seat. Huh.
Another interesting food from Emilia-Romagna is Lambrusco. And Lambrusco, I learned, means wild grape. And it's kind of a fizzy, acidic, slightly sweet wine that's traditionally served, interesting, with salumi. You know, all the meats and stuff that come from Bologna. Mm-hmm. So it all is in the same region. And also it's with a rich, really rich meat pasta sauces. So all the products kind of go together and kind of blend and just make a wonderful choices to have while there. And while I was there, it was truffle season.
Now you're singing to me.
So there was one restaurant that made, it was called Lazaria, it was in not far from Bologna, and this woman made fresh pasta, but it was not flour and water. The pasta was half Parmesan cheese, half bread and egg. So it was kind of a thick pasta cheesy thing. And I wrote about this on Bite of the Best, and I have a picture there with the shaved truffles over. It was the day I arrived, and you know how kind of out of it you are because you didn't sleep. I'm sorry?
Jet lagged.
Yeah.
Right?
Jet lagged. That was the word, right?
Yeah, I'm still suffering from that. Yeah.
And that's what I ate. And I was like, oh, I'm, you know, probably too tired to eat. But I took one bite of that, and I just became alive. It was absolutely wonderful, wonderful. Mm-hmm. And then I went to a gelato factory and got a diploma in gelato making at Gelato University.
How many pounds did you put on during this trip?
This is good.
I actually lost weight because I made sure I walked 5 miles every day.
Good for you.
Yeah. And how nice to make. What kind of gelato did you make?
I actually made, because they started it for me, it was grapefruit and what's that bitter aperitif?
Fernet Branca?
No,
Cinzano or Campari?
Campari, I'm sorry. Campari grapefruit gelato was the one that I made.
So that's more like a sorbetto. Right?
Or was it creamy? Yeah, that was, it ended up creamy like gelato.
Wow. Huh.
And the difference, you know, the difference between gelato and ice cream, and everyone goes, well, gelato is, you know, it's Italy's name for ice cream, but it is, but they are different. Their fat is much less than an American version, and they also have less overrun, so it's not aerated like our ice creams are.
You got me drooling, as usual, Bonnie. Okay, people want to check out more, they go to biteofthebest.com, And thank you so much for all those tempting treats that you've talked about.
I'm doing an Italian for lunch.
I'm going to do Italian too. You talked me right into it.
I wish I lived closer so I could join you.
I wish you could too. But anyway, Bonnie, we'll talk to you soon. And thanks again.
All right, thanks.
All the best. Arrivederci. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to Switzerland on Swiss International Airlines. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Inside Scoop on Santa Barbara restaurants every week on Nippers Table Talk Thursdays at 9 a.m. on KZSB AM 1290 and on the web at nippers.com.
As we fly across the globe, leaving Italy, and now heading to Switzerland. You know, I went over to Switzerland 2 weeks ago and spent the last 2 weeks going all over and actually producing what will become, in the next few weeks, what we call the Best of Switzerland shows. Oh, cool. Every show, we're going to have a little segment about a different aspect of Switzerland, different place, different destination. And it was really, I've always been a huge fan of Switzerland. I feel, I used to live there.
Yeah, right.
And I used to go to school there.
Yeah.
But just going back and seeing how it continues to reach new heights, and not just the mountains.
Uh-huh. And by the way, how was the skiing?
Skiing was terrific. I was very lucky because, you know, they didn't have much snow at Christmas mm-hmm. this year. But just when I arrived, they'd gotten a nice little dump. And while I was there, they got a huge, huge snowfall.
Oh,
so lots of good skiing, and I think it's going to continue on through the winter into spring.
Good news.
But while I was there, it was beautiful conditions. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was sunny,
and
it was warm. It was nice. It was like springtime skiing.
Yeah.
Well, the first thing about going over to Switzerland is, how do you get there? Well, the best way, without a doubt, if you're certainly coming from the West Coast, is to fly on Swiss, either out of Los Angeles or San Francisco.
Yeah.
They have direct service to Zurich, which is a great trip. It's easy.
Mm-hmm.
It leaves here in the afternoon, mm-hmm. and you arrive in Switzerland in the afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a nice afternoon to get to wherever you're going if you're not going to be right in Zurich.
Right.
And then coming back, it leaves in the afternoon and gets to L.A. in the late afternoon.
Right.
So again, you know, timing-wise, it's perfect.
Yeah.
I've always been a fan of Swiss because I think they do, first of all, dependable, they run on time, kind of like the clocks they have, but also they've got great food and beverage.
Yeah.
In business class, they were serving raclette. I was thinking about you. Now, where can you get raclette on any other aircraft?
For people that don't know what raclette is, it's a type of cheese.
It's a melted cheese.
That you melt and you pour
and they put
it
with potatoes.
On potatoes, and then you serve it sometimes with some air-dried beef or vegetables, and certainly you want those little...
And they had the little gherkins and the little onions, all that was there, and I'm going, this is too great. I mean, I'm happy with the other meals they serve too, but I mean, I have raclette. And now on the new at the new first class lounge, which I got to see, I didn't stay in it, but the new first class lounge at Zurich Airport in Terminal E, in the wintertime, you can sit on the terrace and have raclette or fondue. Is that just the best?
That's a good
Are they thinking? I think they're thinking. Anyway, just to give you an overview of where I went. So I started in Zurich. I went to the Dolder Grand Hotel, which is a hotel that dates back to the 1890s.
Wow. Okay. Was it near the lake?
It's above. It actually is one of the highest points looking over the lake. It's about 10 minutes from downtown Zurich. It's pretty close. But it's famous for many reasons. Now the biggest reason is the owner, Mr. Schwarzenbach, has got one of the greatest modern art collections in all of Europe.
Wow.
And it's in the hotel. It's sculptures around the grounds and these incredible, one of the largest Andy Warhol is at the reception desk.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, if no other reason to go to the Dolder, just to see the art would be one reason, but the other reason is the food, which is unbelievable. It's a two-star Michelin restaurant
there.
And we're going to be talking about it later in the shows. Also went to Samaritz, which I love Samaritz. I went there as a kid. That's where I learned to ski as a little kid. Mm. My parents used to go there. And
changed a little since then?
Not that much, you know. It's still got, I mean, it's always been a very stylish destination. Mm-hmm. Johannes Badrut founded Samaritz as far as a hotelier goes. He took over the Klum Hotel back in the 1800s, and he enticed some Brits to come and visit Switzerland in the wintertime, because it used to be people go there in the summer.
Right.
But he said, no, there's a lot to do in the winter, and it is the birthplace of winter competitive sports.
They do polo there, don't they?
They do polo
winter
there.
Polo?
They have, of course, the Cresta Bob run, you know, and the bobsled run. Mm-hmm. They've got ice skating. They've got all kinds of stuff going on. It's terrific. Yeah. And they also had Gourmet Week going on while I was there. They had nine...
You lucked out.
Oh, I did. They had nine chefs from Japan come and do their signature dishes, including Nobu, who was there.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, it was off the charts amazing. By the way, I got around Switzerland on Swiss Rail, using the Swiss Rail Pass, which is something that you can get on myswitzerland.com. Mm-hmm. It's a great way to travel because you can buy them for, you know, 3 days, a week, 16 days, whatever period of time you want. And you just get on the train, and they go everywhere in Switzerland. I mean, I took trains, and they're always, like, there's one every 15 minutes going where you need to go.
And they're clean and
quiet. And you got, you know, on your iPhone or your iPad, you've got all the schedules. It tells you what platform it's going to be on. It tells you where the first class cabin is going to be, where the food car is going to be, which I did check out.
Yeah.
Great to travel in Switzerland by rail. I would prefer that over having a car as far as getting around. It's just so much easier. I also went to Zermatt, one of my other favorite mountain destinations, where the Matterhorn lives. And I saw the Matterhorn from every window of the hotel I was staying in, called the Cervo Mountain Boutique. Remember they were involved with our Sweepstakes of Switzerland promotion a few years back? Always wanted to go check it out. Boy, what a great prize that was for that young lady who won it. It is a beautiful ski-in, ski-out hotel in Zermatt. And it's right at the end of a ski run, and people go right to the bar there or go to the restaurant to eat, but it is absolutely stunning. Great food, all chalets, they're interconnected chalets, so you're like in your own little private chalet. Each chalet has its own spa.
Does that cost a night?
It isn't that bad.
Yeah.
It isn't that good, but isn't that bad. No, I mean, it's what it is.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Switzerland's not going to be, it's not a gift.
Yeah.
But really,
they're not on euro, right?
Well, they're on their Swiss franc. But actually, now the dollar Swiss franc is a parity, which is better than it has been.
Yeah.
But you can walk right out of the hotel, and there's an elevator that goes right through the mountain and takes you down to the town.
Oh my goodness!
I mean, even though you're way above the town,
it takes
it right through. I mean, you know, the Swiss engineering is unbelievable.
There.
And there's a lift right next to the elevator that takes you back up to the top of the mountain, the Rothorn, and then you can ski. I mean, it was truly terrific. So we're going to talk about all that in the coming weeks. And, of course, we recommend you, if you want to know more, check out myswitzerland.com, the best place to start if you're going to be traveling to Switzerland. Swiss.com, if you're going to take airlines, you can book your tickets right there online. And Swiss Rail passes, which really are a great way to get around. But anyway, for our first edition for Around the World, let's go and check out Swiss International Airlines.
Around the World to Zurich Airport and Swiss International Airlines. Swiss International Airlines offers non-stop daily service from the west coast of the United States to Zurich, a very popular route both from Los Angeles and San Francisco. Swiss brings long-haul travelers to its hub at Zurich Airport, one of the most advanced airports in Europe, which offers global connections to destinations around the world. At the airport, there is direct rail service with Swiss Federal Railways to the Central Railway Station and to over 350 connections a day. Flying from Zurich, the airport offers comfortable check-in and security processing.
Okay, great.
The gate, terminal E, 12:25, and you can use the new Swiss lounge, terminal B, close to gate E43.
Can't wait to try it out. Thank you very much.
Try it out, it's new.
Here at Zurich Airport, Swiss has got three new lounges. Their Senator Lounge, Swiss Business Lounge, and also Swiss First Class, where you can go on the terrace and have fondue or raclette in the wintertime, or you can take over one of their hotel suites right here at the airport and have a view to an aircraft. Flying to Switzerland on Swiss is like already being there. Swissness permeates throughout the aircraft, from the great food, the team efficiency, and most of all, Swiss hospitality.
Swiss recently received the first of 9 new Boeing 777-300ERs, which arrived with Swiss military escorts to a cheering crowd of aviation fans and local and international media at Zurich Airport. In February of 2016, Thomas Kluwer was appointed the new CEO of Swiss, which coincided with the opening of the new Swiss lounges at Zurich Airport and the flagship arrival of the 777. Zurich Mayor Corinne Monsch was one of the officials to celebrate the new era for Swiss aviation and got a first-hand tour of the aircraft. The 777 seats 340 passengers with state-of-the-art cabin features in all three classes, including wireless internet via broadband connection. First Class provides its own suites that include a 32-inch screen, the largest in the industry, and electrically adjustable window blinds, as well as a personal wardrobe. The current A340 aircraft Swiss has used for long-haul flights has offered great comfort in all three classes. In Business Class, a 1-2-1 configuration in part of the aircraft is more like many first-class cabins of other airlines. They provide reading lamps, universal plugs for iPads and other mobile devices, non-stop premium beverages, and an amenity kit stocked with flight socks, eye shades, earplugs, toothbrush, toothpaste, and even lip moisturizer, which are augmented with additional facial creams and moisturizers, as well as other products available in the restrooms. Business Class meal service provides both meat and vegetarian options, from raclette to a Malaysian rice and vegetable curry. Cappuccinos and espressos made to order make each meal a satisfying experience. The seat controls provide a complete flat bed, back massage, lumbar and cushion support, and even mood lighting. All these features will be enhanced in the new 777, and the A340s will be transferred to Swiss's sister carrier, Edelweiss. From the summer of 2016, the new Boeing 777 will be deployed primarily on service to Hong Kong, Bangkok, and Los Angeles, and several times a week to San Francisco, São Paulo, and Tel Aviv.
Fun. I think in this case, sometimes it's all the fun. I mean, it was just a great way to go, and I can't wait for this 777 service to start flying from Los Angeles to Zurich direct, and I'll be first in line. Anyway, for more information about Swiss International Airlines, check out their website, swiss.com, and also myswitzerland.com, two sites to see when you're going over to the wonderful land of Heidi. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Scott Steepleton is going to take us to the wonderful land of Seattle. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. American boy.
Get the inside scoop on Santa Barbara restaurants every week on Nippers Table Talk, Thursdays at 9 a.m. on KZSB AM 1290 and on the web at nippers.com.
Von Wiesenberger, the lovely Martha Bull, and studios. We go across the globe, and now we're going to switch directions. Same letter, S as in Switzerland, but instead of Switzerland, we're going to Seattle. And we have a guy who's got two S's, Scott Steepleton, who's joining us.
Good morning. Hey there.
Good
Hi,
to have Martha, you. Arthur. Thanks for joining us.
You bet.
That's, Seattle is certainly a destination for many different things. You went on a kind of cultural exploration.
Yeah, it was really neat. Dale Chihuly, who was a Tacoma Washington native. He's got, it's celebrating its fourth year now, the Chihuly Garden and Glass in Seattle. It's at Seattle Center, where if you've been to Seattle, there used to be an amusement park there at Seattle Center, the Fun Forest. Well, the Fun Forest is gone, and now Dale Chihuly Garden and Glass is there. Wow. And Dale Chihuly, world-renowned glass artist, he changed the way that people work with glass. And so he's got this whole entire huge, beautiful exhibit space to his life, his work, and then also to the people who kind of carry it on today, the younger generation of glass artists.
I know when I went to Tacoma to his actual workshop, he had a lot of people working there doing these incredible pieces.
Yes.
That sell for a fortune.
Yes.
It's not cheap stuff.
And what you do on this hot shop tour, which is what I took there, you learned that glass blowing, even though there is the Chihuly name may be behind all of this stuff, it really is a team experience. You need somebody spinning the rod that's got the hot piece of glass on it. You need somebody blowing into that tube. It can be up to, I think, 7 people, the tour guides were saying, to make some of this wonderful
stuff.
Is
he still active in the...
He is. He wasn't there the day we went there, but he's still
That's
doing it.
Thought,
yeah.
Yeah.
Did you go across the glass bridge that they have in Tacoma? Did you actually...
No.
Didn't go over that.
Right. This was all in Seattle. Yeah. Yeah. The Tacoma facility has been there for years.
Yeah.
This one here, the Chihuly Garden Glass, is the newer one. But you know, we did go under a ceiling. There's a ceiling of glass, and then a lot of his Persian glass, which is kind of a jellyfish. If you think of the top of a jellyfish, he calls them Persians.
Mm-hmm.
They are hanging above your head on this piece of glass, on this glass ceiling, and it bathes the room in this beautiful light.
Yeah.
And it's a white walled room, and that's the only room in the entire facility that's white, that isn't the Chihuly gray, they call it, because they want the light from above there to kind of bathe the room in this beautiful colors from all these beautiful pieces of artwork.
They have at the Bellagio too. They have
a huge
collection.
In the lobby of the Bellagio, that's all Dale Chihuly's work. Yeah,
it's spectacular.
And I remember seeing once he did a swimming pool where the bottom of the swimming pool was all glass pieces, and you know, it was just a thought of diving into a pool and seeing these incredible sort of underwater fantasies. But now, he got most of his inspiration, didn't he, from Murano in Italy?
Yes. He's very much the Italy style, Italy trained Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. And the things that he does, though, he looks to American Indian, Northwest American Indian artwork for even some of his inspiration. He's got a whole entire installation of glass baskets, and they resemble Northwest American Indian baskets that were woven, you know, by these hands that he has turned into glass. And just like some of those baskets, the gravity sort of takes hold of the glass and it falls down on itself, you know, just like the weight of the basket might sort of fall in on itself. And then he positions them right next to the baskets. It's really a beautiful place. In some of the rooms you feel like you're undersea, some of the rooms you feel like you're on the moon, you're floating across a Japanese sea with some ikebana flower arrangement glass pieces. Wow. It really is a gorgeous thing. And what's really neat about the Hot Shop tour, it's $22 per person to get in, but you get there a couple hours before the general public gets there. You get this wonderful tour. You get to see some of these artisans blow glass right there. Mm-hmm. And then you get the run of the place for an hour or so before the general public comes in, and they're paying $22 just to get in. So you've already got the best of both worlds with your $22 admission.
But she can't go because she's like a bull in a china shop. what about now, there's a restaurant there.
Yes,
as well,
it's called the Collections Cafe, and it's right part of the Chihuly Center, and it's called Collections because Dale Chihuly is an avid collector of cigarette lighters, of bottle openers, Mexican sort of ashtrays. I mean, all sorts of things. Accordions. The ceiling is lined with accordions. Now, he didn't play the accordion, but his father and his brother were accordion players. And so the Collections is a nod to the 27 or so collections that are either sunk down into your table, hang on the walls, or suspended from the ceilings.
He sounds very eclectic.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
And then wasn't he into motorcycles, too?
He's done a load of everything, yes. Yeah.
Now, in the restaurant, is the cooking artistic?
It's beautiful. There was a beet salad that was terrific. Every day there's a different special. There was the cream and the soup we had was the roasted pepper salad. Roasted pepper soup.
Roasted pepper soup.
Yeah.
I have that actually all the time. Dude, I mean, yeah, I have roasted pepper soup with a tomato
that
Pacific makes, you know, in those little containers. Anyways, I'm sure his was
It's a great place, place.
And so good food.
Yeah.
And you're surrounded by all these collections. And then you go in the Hot Shop and watch up. Now, is there a store?
Oh, of course there's a store.
And sell everything. At the end of the ride, there's a checkout area, right?
Yes, sell everything. And he's got to deal with Pendleton. You know, and so there's a lot of Pendleton stuff that is Dale Chihuly inspired clothing, as well as some rugs, like throw rugs, blankets, that kind of thing. Yeah.
Wow.
And does he sell any glass there?
Oh yeah. Yeah. There's glass.
But that's in a special area, right?
Well, no. I mean, it's right there. It's in a special area in that the price tag has about four figures instead of, you know, the other price tags maybe two or three.
Yeah, and I guess you know, if you handle it as broke, consider it sold, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Absolutely. It's all yours.
Yes.
Wow. But I mean, they are amazing pieces.
Yes.
And as you said, you can go to many great hotels and see chandeliers that are Chihuly chandeliers. Chihuly, yeah. And
he's amazing.
Yeah.
It's one of those great American artists. We're lucky to have it. Well, what a cool thing to
do.
Now, if people want to know more about it, is there a website they can
go? It's chihulygardenandglass.com.
Easy.
Yep.
And if you want to go to Seattle, I guess you go to Seattle.com.
Yes, and you know, you can fly right out of Santa Barbara.
That's true.
Yeah.
Cool.
Stay at Inn at the Market. Inn at the Market,
yeah.
Beautiful hotel. It's the only hotel at Pike Place Market.
Really?
That's innatthemarket.com. There is a Beecher's Loft, which is named for Beecher's Cheese, which is right there. The owner of Beecher's Cheese has this loft. It's a 1,400 square foot loft. Spectacular views of the Sound, of the new Seattle Great Wheel, the public market, walking distance to all that stuff. It's a $1,700 a night loft, but boy, if you want to have a special occasion for two or a few more than two, this would be the place to do
it. Oh, you got more than two in that room?
You can have four overnight, and you can have probably 12 or 20 during the day to party.
Wow. Sounds like a good party.
Nice. Yes.
Or else very controversial. Yeah. All right, Scott. Well, thank you so much.
You bet.
For you coming in and sharing those insights about the Chihuly destination, which
I'd like to see
reason to go to Seattle right there.
Absolutely.
Okay, we appreciate it. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to find out about the best city in the United States, according to the Lonely Planet. Stay tuned, we'll be right back. Inside Scoop on Santa Barbara restaurants every week on Nippers Table Talk, Thursdays at 9 a.m. on KZSB AM 1290 and on the web at nippers.com. Interesting to find out what is best and who votes why and what makes something best. But I was thrilled to hear this one, and we're going to have Rebecca Warren join us from Lonely Planet to clue us in on Lonely Planet's best place in the U.S. to visit in 2016. And Rebecca, hi there.
Hi, how are you today?
Thanks for joining us. We're great, and of course, we think where we are is the best place to visit in the United States.
We're not on this
and,
list.
And Santa Barbara, but you know what? I mean, there are other great cities, and you've got one you want to name. Which is number one?
Philadelphia. Philadelphia is this year's top choice for Lonely Planet in the U.S.
Wow.
Tell us why.
How did Philadelphia come as top place? Because, I mean, I've only had their cream cheese, so I don't know.
Well, Philly has really been all the world lately. 2015 was a really exciting year for them. The Pope visited. And 2016 is going to be even more exciting. We have the 40th anniversary of Rocky, everyone's favorite boxer. we can all run up those 72 steps to the top of the Art Museum. It's also going to host the Democratic National Convention in July. And it has a really exciting vibe in some of its up-and-coming neighborhoods, such as East Passyunk, which has an amazing food scene, fantastic array of cuisines from Malaysian to Nordic to traditional but kind of upscale Italian. So it's just kind of got everything going on at the moment.
And wow. do you take into account weather?
I'd rather well, be in Santa Barbara. We find travelers, some prefer hot climates, some prefer cold. Mm-hmm. So Philly will give you both.
That's true.
Depending on the time of year.
And how about crime? Is there a crime issue in Philadelphia?
All major cities, you know, require that travelers are aware of their surroundings and are conscientious travelers at all times. But Philly is a great place to visit. The places that we highlight in our article on lonelyplanet.com, you know, are well-traveled with lots of tourists. But people should always be prepared and cautious whenever they're in an unfamiliar environment, whether it's a small town or a big city.
So when you guys get together and decide which place you're going to give this accolade to, is it a consensus by writers for Lonely Planet who have been to that city, or do you analyze data? How does it work?
It's actually a kind of a long process. We have writers out across the U.S. at all times. And we call for nominations, and we have our writers nominate their favorite places in the past 12 months, and then the U.S.-based editorial team also nominates places. Then the editorial team will take all the nominations and we'll discuss them, and these discussions can be quite long and sometimes quite impassioned. Mm-hmm. But we take into account mainly the timeliness of the nomination. So America has so many wonderful places to travel, so what we try to make the unique feature of this list is that this year has a particular hook or call to bring travelers something special to this destination.
Mm-hmm. Because it sounds like there are a lot of interesting things going on this year in Philadelphia, and I bet they must be thrilled. I mean, that's such great news for a destination.
I'm looking at the rest of the list.
Okay, tell us some of the other ones.
I'm fascinated. Alaska, like you didn't even say a city, you just said Alaska. You can go.
No, we think the whole state is, it's such a state of extremes and such vast wilderness that you can't really find anywhere else in America, that we think the whole state is worth a look.
Yeah,
from the Aleutian Islands to, you know, Denali National Park, there's just such a vast array of experience to be had in that state.
Yep, I agree. And great crab and great salmon.
Yeah, absolutely.
in the dining, which is my forte.
I like Birmingham, Alabama. I visited there once.
Yeah?
I loved it.
Really?
It's just a gem.
Huh.
Yes, we agree. We think it's really, with the revitalization of the Avondale neighborhood and the food and dining scene, there are breweries, there's a really unique kind of southern elevated food scene there where it takes traditional foodways and really bring in more of the modern locavore flavor to these traditional recipes. It's outstanding.
Wow. So, Rebecca, if people want to read the whole list, they can go on Lonely Planet's website.
Absolutely, lonelyplanet.com. Absolutely,
and you
yes.
Look for the best in the U.S., right? Which is the
best in the U.S.
And you've got all the ones listed there, right?
But we have our.
But
we
you
have
forgot
our
Santa Barbara, right? You forgot Santa.
Santa Barbara is a perennial. We think people should visit there every year.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Well, we love you then. Thank you, Rebecca. Well, it's a fascinating thing. I'm so thrilled that you, for Philadelphia, and thank you for sharing those insights with us. And we look forward to having more Lonely Planet on around the world in the future.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking to you.
All right.
Thank
Take care. You. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Well, I can't believe it's already time to cool our jets, they are from a 777 or whatever they're from.
Yeah.
Next week on Around the World, we're going to go to San Moritz. We're going to visit the Klum Hotel.
Uh-huh.
You're going to learn all about the Gourmet Week and a guy named Reto Mathias, who is really making the food scene happen in San Moritz. He has a restaurant called Marmite right on the Corvilla Mountain. Imagine skiing to a 5-star meal. That's what happens up there.
I would just stay there.
You just stay there. Forget the skiing part. All right. Well, thank you all for watching. We'll see you next week. And in the meantime, happy trails.
Thank you for traveling with us today on Around the World. We hope you'll join us for another adventure next week. In the meantime, all of us at Around the World wish you happy trails.